spanning over 100 miles or 160 kilometers in length and connecting the Mediterranean Sea to the Red Sea. The Suez Canal is a critical lifeline for international trade, facilitating the movement of goods between Europe, Asia, and Africa. The canal's sheer size and strategic location have made it a vital conduit for world commerce, revolutionizing the shipping industry and shaping the global economy as we know it today. In this video, we'll delve deeper into the fascinating history, construction, and significance of the Suez Canal. Chapter 1. The Ancient Suez Canal. Today's waterway between Port Said and the city of Suez was not actually the first Suez Canal. The surrounding areas of the Isthmus of Suez have been populated by civilizations for over 5,000 years now, and the idea of connecting the Mediterranean Sea with the neighboring Red Sea has been a desire since the ancient pharaohs. While exact details about the path and timeline of the first precursor of the Suez Canal are up for debate, due to 3,800 years of history eroding the evidence, the Canal of the Pharaohs is believed to be the first instance of a man-made connection between the Mediterranean and the Red Sea. Around 1800 BC, during the 12th dynasty of the Middle Kingdom of Egypt, an approximately 100-kilometer long canal, 30 meters wide and 9 meters deep, has been constructed, connecting the most northern extent of the Red Sea, around today's Bitter Lake, with a far arm of the Nile Delta. While the canal doesn't exist anymore, mentions in Egyptian, Roman, and Greek ancient literature, excavated harbor structures at the proposed course of the canal, and clear indications on modern satellite imagery are bringing up a strong case in favor of its existence. Factors such as a receding Red Sea, silt accumulations in the Nile, harsh desert conditions, lack of advanced excavation machinery, and desert sand continuously filling the canal eventually meant that the canal's existence was at the mercy of the current leader. And after approximately 1,500 years, when the Romans conquered Egypt, it is said to have fallen to complete disuse. When the Isthmus was under occupation of the Arabic Caliphate around the year 600, an attempt was made to revive the canal, but it never regained its former significance. Many other attempts have been made to reconnect the seas, among them the Venetians, the Ottomans, and Napoleon, but none of the efforts ended up bearing any fruit. During Napoleon's surveying campaign of the Isthmus, the elevation of the region has been mapped in detail, and further thoughts to build a new north-south canal from the Mediterranean to the Red Sea have been stopped due to the incorrect measurements that the Red Sea lays 8.5 meters higher than the Mediterranean. As the 19th century progressed, this misconception has been rectified, however, which eventually led to a group of British and French civil engineers taking up the task, which ended up leading to today's Suez Canal. Chapter 2. The Construction. Friendly connections between the French diplomat Ferdinand de Lesseps and the then Egyptian Vahid Said Pasha led to a quick development of the project in the 1950s. And by 1956, detailed plans and drawings have been created outlining the course and construction phases of the future Suez Canal. A group of 13 European civil engineering experts checked and approved the reports, giving a green light to the project, despite the British government fearing a reduction of influence when they would no longer hold the monopoly on East Asian trade, as the land route and the route around Cape Horn would become less necessary. On April 25, 1859, the excavation works finally began at the newly founded Port Said, named after the Egyptian ruler. It is estimated that at any time around 3,000 people were working in parallel, and horrific labor conditions in the first few years of the project sparked growing criticism among the European investors. After 5 years, the so-called corvée system, a form of forced labor, where peasants were required to provide free labor to the state, was cancelled, leading to paid labor becoming the new norm. This step drastically bettered the mortality rate for workers on the project and led to a successful completion of the project just 10 years after the groundbreaking ceremony. In total, an estimated 1.5 million laborers from all over the world were employed on the project, only equipped with pickaxes and shovels. The works were painfully slow in the beginning, but a shortage of labor after the abandonment of forced labor led to some state-of-the-art inventions. Utilizing steam and coal-powered excavators and dredges gave the project the boost it needed, and a fleet of roughly 100 heavy machinery ended up removing 75% of the sand in the last 2 years alone. After 10 years, a total of 74 million cubic meters of sand and rock has been removed, enough to fill the Great Salt Lakes almost four times. And on November 17, 1869, an inauguration party consisting of several European nobility made their way down the canal from Port Said. During the inauguration ceremony, the narrow canal and uneven depth already foreshadowed a reoccurring issue of the canal, with one ship running aground, turning in the canal, and blocking passage for the rest of the party. Chapter 3. The Suez Canal throughout history. The completed Suez Canal had a slow start after its completion, but in the following years, its significance for the world economy only increased. The largest beneficiaries of the canal were the Mediterranean countries, which now had a way quicker route to Asia, and the connection is said to have drastically increased European colonization of Africa. From the beginning, the canal's goal was to be accessible by all vessels, regardless of their origin, but having such a narrow choke point in the supply line made many people nervous of potential unrests in and around the canal. This fear led to a British invasion of the canal in 1882, and the British held control over the canal for the next 70 years. In the 1950s, Egypt regained sovereignty over the canal, but immediately blocked access to Israeli vessels, leading to the so-called Suez Crisis, in which the British, French, and Israelis launched a military operation on the Sinai Peninsula to regain control of the canal. After international political turmoil, the coalition was replaced by the first United Nations Peacekeeping Corps, but this was not the end of the canal being the center point of war in the region. The Six-Day War of 1967 led to a total of 8 years of closure of the canal. During the Yom Kippur War in 1973, the canal again became a focal point of the war effort, ended up being littered with bombs from the war parties. After they were cleared up by an American fleet of minesweeping helicopters, the canal was reopened in 1975 and finally left the international news. Since the last closure, the canal saw an average of 17,000 transits per year and only drew attention due to several blockages. Since the turn of the century, the Ever Given was not actually the only ship blocking the canal. The Tropic Brilliance in 2004, the Okal King Dor in 2006, the OOCL Japan in 2017, and finally the Ever Given in 2021 have drifted sideways in the canal for various reasons, blocking the canal and costing billions of dollars to the world economy. Chapter 4. The Suez Canal today and beyond. As we continue through the 21st century, the Suez Canal has become more important than ever for global trade. In 2022, the canal has seen its second busiest year since its inception, seeing around 12% of the entire world's trade volume floating through its waters. This is partially due to the recent completion of the largest modernization project in the canal's history. A parallel shipping lane between the Suez Canal Bridge and the Great Bitter Lake drastically increased the capacity and lowered the potential impact of stuck ships such as the Ever Given in 2021. Continued modernization of the infrastructure, traffic management system, and security measures ensure the safety and efficiency of the waterway. But despite these massive investments, the future of the Suez Canal is not certain. Alternatives such as the Arctic shipping route along Russia's northern coast may become a valuable alternative for northern European countries on their way to China, South Korea, and Japan. With a total of only 62 transits in the year 2020, this route still has a lot of potential, but harsh weather conditions are still scaring many logistics firms. In conclusion, the Suez Canal is a testament to human ingenuity and determination. From its ancient origins to its modern-day significance, the canal has shaped the course of history and connected the world in ways previously unimaginable. While it had troubling times as a battleground of the Cold War, the status as a shipping lane for all vessels, regardless of their flag, persists to this day. And as humanity, we can only hope that this status will never be questioned again. If you want to hear about another large-scale engineering project, you should check out this one about the Fehmarn Belt Tunnel. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, be sure to subscribe and leave a like. Cheers.